Welcome to my series on procedural generation. In this first video, I'll introduce you to the subject at hand and tell you a bit about the structure of this series. So let's start with that. I'll try to make all videos as independent as possible, but sadly, that's just not possible if I want to touch on slightly more advanced topics, and so at the beginning of each video, I will state what other video or videos you need to watch first. But keep in mind, the series won't be linear. Instead, it will be more like a tree where different videos start different branches that might then reunite at some point or just end. As for what I'll cover, well, I don't even really know myself. There are so many things I want to make videos on, but for the beginning, I will cover basic stuff such as planes, circles, spheres, noise, height maps, and terrain generation. If there is something you would like to know more about, just leave a comment with it and I'll see if I can make a video on it. Now for the things you need to know. You should already know how to program a bit. Being comfortable at working with arrays is really important as we'll use them all the time. The code I'll be showing will be pseudocode, so that way you can write it in any language you wish to. As for the program you'll use to render and display the things we generate, that is up to you to decide. You can use a rendering API such as OpenGL, Vulkan, DX, or Metal, but you could also use game engines such as Godot, Unreal Engine, or Unity. I will leave some links in the description to tutorials on how to display geometry with some of these different pieces of software. As for me personally, I will be using OpenGL with C++ to render everything. If you want to do the same, you can check out my OpenGL series. And that brings me to the final requirement for this series, the more theoretical knowledge you should have. Knowing vector maps and the basics of linear algebra is basically a must since we'll be working with vectors and matrices constantly. Knowing the theory behind different computer graphics concepts will also help, especially when we get to the more advanced topics, but it's not necessarily needed, at least not to a certain point. Now, as you may know, the realm of computer graphics is not standardized, and so there are different conventions out there. I'll state the conventions I'll be using in this series now. Don't worry if you don't know what all of them mean, you will stumble upon them at one point or another in the form of a logic bug in your code. I'll be using counterclockwise backface calling, a right-handed coordinate system where X points to the right, Y up and Z backwards, UVs start in the bottom left corner, positive rotation is counterclockwise, rotations are in radians, quaternions are XYZW, where W is the scalar, and I will be using column major matrices, but I will present them in their normal mathematical notation. So for example, on the left you can see the mathematical matrix, and on the right you can see how I would write it in code. Now let's look at some of the basics of procedural generation. First, make sure you can get the triangle up on the screen using the guides I left in the description. 99% of the time, this will be our building block for the things we generate. Once you learn how to make a triangle appear on the screen, the possibilities are endless. Now, in order to make this triangle appear, we had to define three vertices, each with a position, and an array of indices which specify the order of the vertices in the drawing of the triangle. If we were to inverse the order of the indices, the triangle should disappear since we'll be looking at its back and its back should not be drawn in order to save some computational power. If this is not the case for you, make sure to Google how to enable backface calling for your program. Getting triangles to face the side we want them to face will be something we'll always have to keep in mind. Now let's look at some of the tools we have. First, pause the video and draw a square. Okay. I hope you only defined 4 vertices and 6 indices. If you define 6 vertices, 3 for each triangle, you are wasting space by having 2 pairs of identical vertices. It is good to try and avoid this sort of duplication, but at the same time, keep in mind that vertices can have more than just positions. And they could also have colors, for example. In that case, we would be justified in using 6 vertices if it meant each vertex would have its own unique color, like here. But now, let's go back to the 4 vertices and 6 indices and ask ourselves if there is an even more efficient way of doing this. The answer is yes. Right now, we are using the triangle primitive type. but there are multiple types of primitives. For example, we could use a triangle fan. The first vertex of this primitive type will be the center of a fan, while all other subsequent vertices forming triangles around it. If we were to use this primitive, we could get about with only using 4 vertices and 4 indices, which is the minimum amount of data we need to make a square. Other primitives include triangle strips, lines, line strips, line loops, and points. We'll mostly be using the normal triangle for our generations and use points and line loops or line strips for debugging. So let's finally start by doing some procedural generation. For now, we'll be making an algorithm that randomly generates a triangle somewhere on the screen. This would be really easy without backface calling, because we could just get 3 random positions and the triangle will always appear. So we'll make sure to not draw the backface so that we are forced to make the triangle face us. This is the algorithm I propose. We first generate a random position on the screen. Then we generate a random positive number and use that as the radius of a circle that will have its center on the position we just made. Now we'll generate another random number that will represent an angle on our circle. The thing about circles is that the points on them can be really nicely described as vectors like so. So to get our first vertex, we get a vector on the circle using the radius and angle, and then we add that to the position of the circle itself. Now to get the other 2 points, we just have to increase the angle by 2 random numbers, which added together should not exceed the full rotation, since then the triangle might not face us. Now let's see how this would look in code. We want to start off by setting a seed. A seed is a number that decides the sequence of our randomly generated numbers. And yes, they aren't really randomly generated if we can predict the sequence. Instead, we call them pseudo-random numbers. They're very useful for procedural generation because using the same seed, we can generate the same results over and over, which allows us to debug more easily, or simply regenerate something we like. If you ever played a game with random terrain generation, such as Minecraft, you will notice they usually have a field where you can input a seed. Now for the actual algorithm implementation, we want a function that outputs an array of positions while taking in a radius. We start by randomly generating the center of the circle, and then we simply loop 3 times, generating the vectors on the circle, adding them to the center, and putting them into an array, which we then output at the end. As for the indices, they're really straightforward. Now, you should be able to generate random triangles on your screen using an over-engineered method. But what's cool about this method is that we can slightly modify the algorithm and make a circle. We can simply loop, let's say, 100 times instead of 3 times, and instead of having random angles, we'll increase the angle each time by a full turn divided by 100. Now, if you use a triangle fan, we should get a result that looks like this. It's a circle. Good job on your first step into procedural generation. I've left an exercise at the end of this video, but for now, if you have any questions, drop a comment below or join my Discord server in the description. A big thank you to my supporters on Patreon who allow me to produce higher quality content by paying for the software and hardware I use. If you want to support this content, feel free to join them. All relevant links are down in the description. Bye!